Stoppers. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I am so happy to see you all here on this rainy day, coming out to praise and worship the Lord. First off, Emily, do you want to do your thing?
Sure.
Okay. Well, before we get going here.
We are about 6 weeks away from our camp house day. I actually have an official clipboard now. Our date is August 18th and 19th. I heard from Dave this week, so I said I just need to have more information because everyone's asking me and I didn't have a lot. So what the cost is going to be, if you go for the day on Saturday, because they're going to do lunch and dinner with the pizza stove oven, it's going to be $10 per adult, $5 per child. If you choose to spend the night there in the cabins, it's $60 a cabin a night. So for like my family, it's going to be all in one cabin. But if there's like a couple, we'll share or whatever. So they just need to have a count because they are staffing that weekend. We are just showing up as their guests and hanging out and canoeing and fishing and all that good stuff. So if you are thinking you are going to come, even if it's just for the day, please sign up so that I know, so that I can give them a head count, so that they know how much food to keep and have there for us. So it is a little ways away, but at least you know, sign up if you're thinking for sure you're going to go. So, thank you.
I'll put this in the back.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Camp host day. All right. I would like you all to stand as you're able for our call to worship. Please respond with the bold print. For God's greatness is wondrous to behold.
Everywhere we look, we can see the imprint of God.
From the loftiest mountains to the crashing waters of the seas,
there God's greatness stands majestically.
God's greatness can be within the human heart.
Let us honor and praise God with the acts of loving kindness and compassion.
Please join me in our opening prayer. Lord of mystery and community,
you have called us here to remind us of the mission journey you set before us. Help us pay attention to the words of Jesus as he sent his disciples on a mission of healing and compassion. Remind us that success is not measured in the cures, but in the striving. Enable us to truly be your disciples in this world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
can or you don't have to answer. Do you ever make a mistake?
I
make some doozies. As a matter of fact, I did one yesterday, but I'm not going to tell you about it because it was a really good one. When you get stressed out, you make some mistakes, and maybe aren't the kindest person in the whole world. But anyway, this is not your confession, so we'll keep right on here. Okay, I have a couple other questions for you, okay? So, how many gallons of water are in the ocean? No, you don't know. You don't know that one yet, huh? Well, there's 3.612 times 10 to the 20th power. That's 21 zeros behind 3.6. That's a lot of gallons of water. So how many stars in the universe, you suppose? 10 million, that's a really good guess. And the answer is 76 trillion. As you can see, I am reading off here because I do not know these answers. That's 7 with 22 zeros behind it. That takes a long time just to write that number, right? Okay, how about how many grains of sand? Even more. So here, it is 7 quintillion. I didn't even know that was a number. 500 quadrillion. That's a lot. So, the point of all that is that even if those numbers aren't exactly all super correct, the point is that God's grace and God's forgiveness is bigger than all the water in the ocean or the sands on the beaches or the stars up in the sky. We could empty all those out and we still wouldn't have as much love and forgiveness and grace that God gives us every single day. So we just have to remember that God is bigger than all those things, all those zeros behind those numbers. God's forgiveness is infinite. Doesn't that make sense?
Yeah.
Should we say a little prayer?
All right.
Oh, good and loving God, thank you for being in our lives and for taking care of us and for forgiving us and giving us grace every single day of our lives. Thank you. Amen. All right. Thank you for coming down. Here you go.
Cross over, I will.
join me in our prayer confession. Help us to unclutter our lives, Lord,
because we have so much. We humbly ask you to give us vision so that we see this world through others' eyes and not just our own. Show us how to be more compassionate so that we can see where there is need and where we can use our gifts rather than turn away in the face of hardship. Show us how to be grateful for what we have rather than mourn for what we lack. Amen.
Let's now be in a few moments of silent confession. Do not be afraid of derision of others. Place your trust in God's call and guidance. Know that the Lord is with you always, even to the ends of the earth. Amen. Our scripture, our New Testament scripture lesson this morning comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 1 through 10. It is necessary to boast. Nothing is to be gained by it. But I will go on to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a person in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up in the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I don't know. God knows. And I know such a person. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. Was caught up into paradise and heard things that were not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of such a one, I will boast, but on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. But if I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think better of me than what is seen in me or heard from me, even considering the exceptional character of the revelations. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me, but he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness." So I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong. So ends the reading of this passage. There was a lay reader who stood before the congregation one Sunday to read the scriptures. Well, he was reading the lesson straight from the large pulpit Bible that a lot of churches have. And the reading was from where we are today in 2 Corinthians. But the reader was having a difficult time finding it in the Bible. He couldn't find his place. So to the congregation's mounting suspense, he flipped this way in the Bible, and then that way in the Bible, and then back the other way, until finally he found his place, and he read with a grin on his face, "I am a fool." It took a while for the congregation to stop laughing before he was able to continue. But it was one of those memorable moments in that church. One of those moments, if you were there, you would never forget it, because it is one of those authentic moments that reminds us of our common humanity, even in church, a time when we are usually trying to have our best face on and we have our highest intentions before us. I'm sure all of us have such moments that we can remember, although hopefully that they all happen to somebody else and not us. And hopefully it didn't happen in church. Or maybe it did, and that's why we remember it so vividly. It was exactly such an opinion that St. Paul had in mind when he apologized repeatedly in 2 Corinthians for being a fool. He was being a fool. He was putting on pretenses, and he was boasting to compete with the so-called super apostles in Corinth who were boasting of their own prowess in their attempt to undermine Paul. Sometimes and somehow I imagine them all in their expensive suits with perfectly coiffed hair, just a little bit of grain at the temples, with their impressive certificates lining the walls of their office or on their website. And then there's Paul, raggedy tent maker that he was. He was balding, he was often getting into trouble, he wasn't a great speaker, he wasn't even that great of a presence in person. No wonder he was losing ground. But then, speaking as a fool, Paul joins the frogs. He shares an experience that is one of the most puzzling but revelatory confessions in the whole letter. If these people want to match spiritual experiences, Paul says, I could go there. Even as he does, he avoids the first person, though. I know a man, he says, a man caught up into paradise, who saw and heard things he can't even talk about. And then confessing that it was actually him, he goes on to say, therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given me in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. Three times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. For power is made perfect in weakness. A thorn in the flesh, what do you suppose it was? No one really knows, though many have speculated. Was it bad eyesight? Did he have a hearing problem? Maybe he had malaria or a speech impediment. Stomach problems? Mobility issues? But really the question is not what, but actually why, which Paul also answers. Whenever I am weak, boasts Paul, then I am strong. How can we hope to understand such a peculiar, paradoxical assertion? Can it really be that the power of God is most known in our lives, not in our strengths, but actually in our weaknesses? It's the case that the quality God hates most, could it be that we as humans exhibit arrogance? Could that be what God really dislikes the most in humans? And maybe it's love or humility that God most cares about in humans. It is, for example, true in the lives of nations. As we look toward the 4th of July this week, it feels as though the American character has been formed most and best, not in the times of peace and prosperity, but in times of suffering and struggle. 150 years before the Revolutionary War, the Pilgrims at Plymouth endured brutal winters. In fact, the history books indicate that 46 out of the original 102 colonists, nearly half of them, perished from lack of fresh food to eat and the inability to treat the resulting diseases. One historian noted that the new Americans made 7 times more graves than huts. Despite this, they set aside a time for Thanksgiving, a day that evolved into our modern Thanksgiving holiday. A century after that came the Revolutionary War that would move us from a colony into an independent nation. Less than 100 years after that, our nation would be torn apart by the Civil War. And less than 100 years after that, Americans fought international aggression in the world, in Europe, and in the Pacific. After that came a different kind of battle, also hard fought, to win civil rights for African Americans. And then on September 11th, we were shaken by a terrorist attack on our country, and all of that had transpired since then. All these events have molded the American character and made us into the nation that we are today. So let's look at how this notion about when we're the weakest, we have strength, and how it applies to the church. When churches and denominations become too self-assured, as the mainline church did in the last part of the 20th century, we lose something vital. When we think it's all because of what we do and how we do it, getting the technique just right, we fail to realize that the whole thing is a faith proposition from beginning to end. That from the beginning to the end depends not on our talents, like those super apostles in Corinth, but more like Raggedy Paul in his weaknesses and in his struggles, emulating our founder, Jesus, whose greatest demonstration of the power and love of God was seen when he was dying on a cross. All across the Minnesota Annual Conference, many churches are meeting their new pastors this morning. Many of them are hoping for super apostles with the wisdom of a 60-year-old who looks like a 30-year-old with a spouse and two children and a very well-behaved dog. They probably like to hear that in their last church, they had 2,000 members, which began from nothing, starting with just his or her own family and their very well-behaved dog. Brings them all in, I know. In contrast, how many would consider a candidate whose resume sounds something like this? I've been a leader in most places I've served. I'm over 50 years of age, and I've never preached in one place for more than 3 years. In some places, I have left town after my work caused riots and disturbances. I must admit, I have been in jail 3 or 4 times, so it really wasn't my fault. My health is not great, though I still accomplish a great deal. The churches I have preached in have been small, even though they were located in several large cities. I've not gotten along well with the religious leaders in towns where I have preached. In fact, some have threatened me and even attacked me physically. I'm not too good at keeping records, and I've been known to forget who and who I haven't baptized. However, if you can use me, I promise to do my best for you. Sincerely, the Apostle Paul. All in the name of transparency, there are no perfect churches, nor are there perfect pastors. Not even Corinth, not even the Apostle Paul. And personally, I want a church that could and would welcome somebody like the Apostle Paul to be their pastor. What Paul had to say about God's strength being revealed in our weakness is also true in our lives as Christians. If I want to learn about the growing pains or the pivotal moments in your life, don't tell me about your strengths, but rather about your challenges, because those are our growing edges. Many years ago, Pastor Paul Miller of the United Church of Canada said, "Life is full of humiliations, or more accurately, of happenings that we interpret as humiliations because they hurt us. Sometimes the voice of humiliation is a friend. Sometimes it's a spouse. Sometimes it's a congregation. Sometimes it's an impersonal evaluation by someone that we don't even know and who doesn't really know us. People tell us things that wound our pride and raise our hackles. What they tell us stings because it seems so unfair and so untrue. And oftentimes, like the statements in a psychological report, they are a mixture of fact and fantasy. But if we listen, and if we listen carefully, we can discover that God speaks to us through these experiences to turn us around." One of my favorite authors is Richard Rohr. He's a Franciscan brother, and I get his meditations every morning, and he speaks the truth. Anyway, he wrote a book entitled Falling Upward, A Spirituality for the Two Halves of Life. What Richard Rohr had to say was this: we spend the first half of our life climbing a ladder of life. Education, jobs, marriage, families. But sooner or later, through our own failure or circumstance or disillusionment, we fall. And sometimes we fall badly. But if we're wise, it's not a fall downward, but a falling upward. And that is the second half of our lives. Free from illusions, we become stronger, we become wiser, we're more compassionate people. And why? Because it's when we are weak that we realize that we cannot do it by ourselves. It's when we are weak that we realize that we must reach out to others. It's not when we're strong, but when we're weak and when we're vulnerable that we open ourselves to the life-creating and renewing power of God. Whenever I am weak, then I am strong, says St. Paul. My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness, says the Lord. In his 1929 book, A Farewell to Arms, Ernest Hemingway put it this way: the world breaks everyone, and afterwards many are strong in those broken places. By the grace of God, may we be those made strong in the broken places of our lives, those places where God's power is made perfect in our weakness. May it be so. Amen. Please stand as you are able for our song of response, There is a Balm in Gilead.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Paul challenged the church at Corinth to recognize their abundance, that they might share with those in need. God calls us to give out of our bounty, that all might have enough to live on without fear. With eager hearts, let us joyfully give out of our abundance. The ushers will now wait upon us for this morning's offering.
Thank you.
an offering prayer. Gracious God,
we thank you for our present abundance and for the many blessings you have bestowed upon this community. We thank you for our faith, for our knowledge of you, and for the assurance of your love. May all these gifts be a blessing to those in need. Amen.
Our offering song is Immortal and Invisible, verse 3.
Paula to our congregation, and I don't know if it's always in your weakness, but God is blessing us with your ministry.
Oh, it's totally in my weaknesses. Thank you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Pray for the people where? In Gettysburg. Oh, definitely. Thank you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Prayers of joy for the wonderful music today and for the joy of spending the last month with our new granddaughter.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Thank you.
Safe travel for Paula and Mike as they head overseas.
Yes, thank you. Yes, we're leaving church right after the service and we're going to be flying to London. So, and it's not a vacation. I'm going on a pilgrimage to visit John Wesley. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Thank you. That group.
For my husband John, who's in need of prayers, he is included
there. For your husband John.
Yes.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
If there are no other prayers, let us bow our heads. Good and gracious God, deep in our hearts, we want our lives to glorify you, but far too often other things get in the way. We come into your house this morning with our hearts and our minds full of questions and burdens. We pray for our town of Two Harbors, O God. We pray for the elderly folks and for the children. We pray for our nation, O God. Sometimes our divisiveness is overwhelming. Help us to remember the things that unite us and teach us to celebrate our differences where they must exist. As we celebrate the birth of our nation this week, make us mindful once again of the sacrifices that have been made for our benefit, and bless those who continue to place themselves in harm's way in acts of war. We pray for our world, Lord, that we would be responsible citizens of it. We pray for our church Do not allow us to ignore injustice. Do not allow us to be desensitized to hunger and disease. Do not allow us to be immobilized by problems that seem too big. Do not allow us to use our differences as an excuse for inaction. And make us a thankful people, Lord. Help us to remember our good fortune and to enjoy it. Help us to slow down long enough to appreciate our friendships and our families, the gifts of marriage and parenthood, the encouragement that we are given by others, and the hope that we're able to offer to all we meet. Where we might have things to feel good about, may those feelings motivate us to treat one another with the generosity and forgiveness you have so often shown to us. We ask all of this in the name of Christ our Lord as we pray as he taught us, our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
In John chapter 6, verse 35, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall not hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. Eating at this table is a holy act by which God gives the word to strengthen and nourish our faith. We eat, we drink, and we receive spiritual bread and drink, which is the bread of life and the living water. It's not just natural food. It's a sacrament of Christ's presence. One is physical and one is spiritual. The soul must be nourished just as the body must be nourished. And that is what happens when we accept the bread and the drink. On the night before Christ was to be arrested and taken away, he was having dinner with the apostles, with his disciples, in the upper room. He knew he was going away. He knew he was not going to be with them much longer. And he needed something physical, something visual, for them to focus on, so that they would carry on his ministry. So what he did is he picked up the bread, and he broke it. And he said to them, this is my body that's going to be broken for you. Remember it and remember me. And when you take and eat, remember what you were placed on earth to do. And then when the meal was over, he took the wine and he poured it. And he said to his disciples, now whenever you take of the wine, whenever you drink it, think of me. Think of as I was dying and my blood was flowing, my blood which was shed for you and for all, for the forgiveness of your sins. Remember that when you drink of the wine. Let us pray. Oh God, we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and the blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We do have a couple of announcements that I just want to lift up. First of all, there's not going to be a study group this week since it's the 4th of July already. Just can't even imagine that. Let's see. And civil suppers are continuing. We always need donations of pop and water if you'd like to donate. And if you would like to volunteer to help out, please see Tanya, and she'll She'll set you up with something to do. Is there anything else that you want to lift up, Jose?
Well, we're working on our stained glass window project, and me and Angela and Sophia finished our beginner's class on Tuesday. So we brought our projects in, so if anybody wants to look at them downstairs afterwards, we'll have them downstairs.
Oh my gosh. So, Sophia, you finished yours? I heard that yours was the most difficult of them all. All right. Oh, there it is. Oh, it's beautiful.
We can show them now.
Wow, okay, let's show them now. And so we have a group of people who are taking it upon themselves to, they will be creating two new windows for that front foyer. So as you can see, we're well on our way with very talented folks. So thank you. Oh, that is super exciting. Okay, wow. Now I'm totally discombobulated. Thank you. Okay. Anything else that anybody would like to raise up? All right, if not, then go with God's blessing. Go be the hands and the feet of Jesus in the community. Go. No matter what your weaknesses are, know that you have strength. Amen. Our sending song is Let All Things Now Living. Please stand here.